about the papers you're being handed out? We don't have a mic yet. It's a very rough outline. Don't follow. Is that so that you can keep to understand kind of the conceptual topics we're talking about? But we do not have a PowerPoint for you because we are not using a PowerPoint. You're going to like it, don't worry. It's going to be very dynamic today and interactive. And that's a really cool one. So don't worry too much, but take notes on that. Before we begin, I want to point out that we like to practice what we preach, and since we both have worked in systems that either are in education systems or support education systems, we know that people have differing learning styles. So you have candy and squishy things and notepads and crayons, except for this table, because they're going to represent the reason we're all here, which is the kids that don't have the resources they need. And the adolescents for adults, it's definitely not because we didn't bring enough fidgets for everybody. It's definitely not because of that. It's very deep. So feel free to share.
And so the sole purpose of them is just, if you're a kinesthetic learner and if your brain works better when you're moving your hands, then please feel free to draw, sketch, fidget, whatever you need to do. You're not using them, but don't feel them.
It's not my table. I don't think they want you to draw on the table. That would have been brilliant. All right. Good morning, everybody. The first session of the day. I'm Dr. Leslie Cook. This is Dr. Fowler. We were not always Dr. Cook and Dr. Fowler. We were at one point roommates, Leslie and Claire Kozak, years ago. So we're here because of the incredible power of good relationships. and because we had good educators and good systems that supported us. So today we're going to be talking micro to macro. We're going to talk about the brain. We're going to talk about mediation and facilitation. We're going to talk about conflict. And then we're going to apply that to the education and the special education system. So you're going to go on a little bit of a journey today. What else did I forget to say? That's it. Yeah, so the title of our training is really teaching your brain how to respond to conflict. The one thing we'd like to do as I burn my retinas is to ask you who you are. And that's not the slide I want. It's something to go back with. So who in the audience are facilitators? Yay. Mediators. Administration. School administration. At the district level? State level? And who else do we have? So if I didn't mention what your role is, what do you do?
Grant manager.
Very good.
Parent support.
Parent support. Very good. Teacher, yay, teachers. All right, I'm a clinical psychologist. I've been in the field for a little while now, and I've done everything from being an autism skills trainer to this, and that name changes all the time. And now I have a private practice where we focus mostly on learning disabilities and autism spectrum, and we are in meetings and mediations all the time. So with that, for the next couple of hours, we're going to discuss the biological mechanisms of stress, and then how that impacts everyone. Impacts your own relationship with yourself, impacts how you interact with staff, with parents, and on a macro scale, how that impacts systems. Anything else you guys would like to take away from today that didn't already kind of touch on? Very specific questions, things you really want us to get into. We don't want to forget you.
We'll be taking a break about halfway through, so if it looks like something you're really excited about isn't being covered, or if there's just something that you think of during the next hour that you want to make sure we talk about, then just come up and let us know.
So much stress management. So I'm going to give you over to Dr. Bell.
Yay. Thank you. Okay. So I grew up here in Eugene, and I remember in elementary school we got to take this. Oh, sorry. Thank you for reminding me. Whoever just turned that up. Hello. Hello. Better? Okay. I don't have much of a voice because we stayed up till 2 in the morning redesigning my pantry. It was really important. It's so clean now. So, when I was in elementary school, we took this field trip where we got to go see the Oregon Trail. And we saw where the. Oh, that color. We saw where the Conestoga wagons went across the plains, and you can still see the dips in the field. So has anybody else been to see that? It was just, yeah, it was amazing that still, you know, all this time later, that you could still see those ruts where the wagons had gone through. So I want you to just keep that image in your head, that here's this great plain, and then there are these ruts from years and years of continual use going down the same path. Okay. So, now keep that image in your head and think about a common conflict that you go through. We'll just say, for instance, not that this relates to me in any way, but just pretend that you get frustrated if your spouse does not take out the garbage. So you come home and say you've worked a long day and you see your spouse sitting there, and we'll just pretend it's Monday Night Football, the Steelers are on. And there's tons of garbage. And you know that you still need to make dinner and you have other things to do. So that would be what we call the entrance to conflict. That there is something that just kind of makes you go. And then let's pretend that you notice, even though you told him he had to get milk, that there isn't milk there. And you're stressed because you've had a really long day. And you're exhausted, and you know there's all this other stuff that has to happen. So now instead of just entering conflict, that conflict starts to escalate, okay? And we'll be ending the presentation by talking about, once that conflict has escalated, what in the world do you do? Because your body is primed to say, okay, I'm upset now. What are we going to do? How am I going to defend myself? How am I going to take care of myself? So your body is really primed, once that conflict is escalated, to just keep it going. But, I mean, obviously we can't do that, or we would never get along, and my husband would be chopped up in pieces somewhere. So we can't do that. That's not a good option. So instead, we need to figure out ways to exit the conflict. We can't find her. We'll be there. Okay. So, number one. Common triggers that enter you into conflict. I'm going to fly through these because we all kind of know this stuff. Stress. Unclear roles. Now, unclear roles, that's a really big one. Little segue, I did my dissertation on workplace conflict, studied approximately 4,000 conflicts, and looked at what in the world causes these. And I really expected it was going to be something kind of sexy that you hear about, like bullying or sexual harassment or, you know, one of the hot topics. It wasn't. One of the main causes of workplace conflict was just unclear roles. People weren't sure exactly what they were supposed to do. And so people would get frustrated with them because they expected them to do something more, or they'd get frustrated because that person was stepping on their toes. And this applies in pretty much every scenario. Again, it applies in the house. I expect him to take out the garbage, right? And he clearly expects me to. It applies with parents and children. It applies in the workplace. It applies just about everywhere you can imagine. Unclear roles are one of the main causes of conflict. Resource scarcity. Let's say, for instance, everybody got a fidget except for one table. They might feel a little left out, like they didn't quite have the resources that they needed to get through their day. Finally, value-based conflict. Again, I'm just trying to fly through these, so if you have questions about any of this, raise your hand. But a value-based conflict. So this is when it goes beyond just, I'm frustrated that you didn't take out the garbage. This goes into, I am feeling betrayed because I thought you were going to take better care of my children and come up with a better option for them, and you didn't. And now I feel like you don't care about my kids. So that's when a little bump in the road becomes a huge Mount Everest, right? That's when a conflict escalates incredibly quickly because it's betraying something that's very personal to you. Does that make sense? Okay.
The one on the left is the one who gets cucumber. The one on the right is the one who gets grapes. The one who gets cucumber, note that the first piece of cucumber is perfectly fine. The first piece he eats. Then he sees the other one getting grape, and you will see what happens. So she gives a rock to us, that's the task. And we give her a piece of cucumber, and she eats it. The other one needs to give a rock to us. And that's what she does. And she gets a grape. And she said, you don't see that. She gives a rock to us now, I'm guessing a cucumber. So this is basically the Wall Street protest that you see here.
So we were just seeing an example of resource scarcity that you can see immediately led into conflict, right? Felt frustrated, and there was no question about it. This is unfair. I was wronged. There wasn't a, let me think about it. Let me try to understand. It's just when people feel wronged, right? You're instantly escalated. So some of the things that led to the poor little monkey feeling frustrated or escalating, felt frustrated, wasn't getting the response that she wanted, lack of validation, feeling attacked or defensive, previous negative experiences. So Leslie will be talking about this a little bit more, mainly. If you've had a bad experience with something in the past, it's likely to bug you again to bug you more now, right? So the last time I asked him to take out the garbage, if it turned into a huge fight, it's going to be more of a charged issue this time, right? That makes sense. Again, value-based conflict is more likely to escalate in external stressors. So if it's not just that I'm frustrated about the garbage, but I'm also frustrated because I had a bad day at work and I also have to do all these other things, okay, that makes little conflicts that would normally be a bump in the road, that makes them escalate very quickly. A very important thing to keep in mind as you're in something like an IEP meeting is that there are all of these external stressors. It's not just that parents are frustrated about their kids, it's that their kid was up all night long screaming, and that dad and the family are all pressuring them to make sure that they're getting the exact right outcome, and that there are all these other stressors going on, adding to the stress that's in the room. Again, we'll go over this a little bit more later, but let's just discuss some of the common exits to conflict in relation to what we're talking about. Is when people feel safe, they feel heard, when they feel like they've won, when they feel like they've lost, but they're okay with that kind of I can agree to disagree. And then the goal is, this is why you should go speak with Chip at the Community Mediation Center and take his great training, is that we want people to know how to collaborate, right? So that's kind of the goal of all of everything that we're talking about here. You want people to have enough knowledge and enough skills when they're in conflict to be able to still have that stress, that angst that says, this is important enough to me, I want to talk about it, but I want to talk about it in a way where I get the results that I want. So that's the goal here. How do we help people collaborate? All right. Yes. Now imagine that you're going down that Oregon Trail, and you're in your lovely little Conestoga wagon, and your family is sleeping, and everybody's snug in their beds, and people are snoring, and then suddenly, you see the conflict cougar. So, your brain recognizes that there's a conflict. Remember when I showed this at the training at the mediation center, and the people there were so lovely, they all said, oh, she's beautiful. She's supposed to be scary. She's supposed to give the feeling of conflict. Okay, when conflict occurs, there are three main things that happen. Number one, we recognize that there's conflict. Number two, we figure out how we're going to react to that conflict. And number three, we decide what our role is going to be. How am I what position do I take in this conflict, right? Do I attack it? Do I submit to it? Okay, so number one, we recognize that there is a conflict. Now, we talked about nature versus nurture. This is very much nature. This is your very first instinctual reaction. There's a cougar. What do I do? So your body starts going through some very extreme physiological changes. Number one, this is an eyeball. Eyeball. All right. Number one, your eyes begin to change. Your ears begin to change. Everything in your body begins to change. Why? Because your body says, oh, cougar, I need to take over. It's kind of like normally we're in a regular democratic society, right? But then as soon as you sense that there's conflict, suddenly martial law takes over. Right? Everything in your body is primed to, how do we deal with this conflict? And your brains are very efficient. So if military law takes over, where does democracy go? It's kind of shoved to the back seat. So, when military law takes over, it takes over all of your systems. We'll talk in a moment about how it changes your eyes, it changes your ears, it changes your heart rate, right? All of a sudden, all of your blood starts pumping. And instead of pumping it to your brain, so you can make these really clear, logical decisions, instead it pumps all of that blood and oxygen to your muscles, okay? So you're ready to take on that cougar if you have to. or you're ready to pick up your kids and run out of the Conestoga wagon if you have to. It also, by the way, so that you can get a really quick burst of energy, it burns a lot of fat. Just saying, you know, could be a new weight loss idea. So, I mentioned that it changes your eyes and your ears. And I want to spend a little bit more time on this because I think it's fascinating. Okay, so normally when Leslie and I talk, my eyes are geared right about here. Okay, everything else is kind of blurred, right? So the main information that my brain cares about is in this range. So I am perfectly tuned to have a conversation with somebody. However, conflict cougar comes up, and now my body changes. And my body says, this is fine. This is not important. What I'm worried about is on the periphery. I'm worried about this cougar that could be approaching and attacking from any direction. So now, instead of focusing on this lovely person in front of me, my brain is Xing out that information and placing more importance on the periphery stuff. So even if I'm trying to have a conversation with Leslie and we're trying to connect, I'm not tuned into her face. I am not tuned into this person that's trying to connect with me, right? I'm not seeing her as a person anymore. I'm just sensing threat. So it's hard to see the humanity in her. It's hard now for me to recognize there's a person that actually wants to connect and have a logical conversation. Okay, second change. That's an ear. That's what that is. Okay. Our hearing also changes. So normally, when Leslie and I are talking, my brain is tuned into the middle decibel range, right? So I am tuned to have a normal conversation with her. If I really pay attention, I can hear there's a rumble of the truck, and I can hear somebody's cell phone just kind of beeped out in the hall. But unless I really focus, right, my brain has tuned all of that stuff out because our brains are so fantastic. They're very efficient, and it wants me to get the most out of what I'm doing right now, which is having a conversation. However, when conflict cougar comes around, then your brain shifts, and it says, this conversation, not important. So it ixnays, it removes most of the information that I'm getting in those middle decibels, and instead it says, things that are now important are perhaps the high-pitched screaming of a baby or the low-pitched rumbling of a cougar, okay? Which is perfect if you're outside fighting a cougar, which is really bad if you're trying to have a normal conversation. So as Leslie and I go through this discussion, all of the logical things she says in the middle range, not really clicking with me. I hear her whining. I hear her whining and crying, and I hear her threatening in the lower ranges. Okay, that's what's really registering for me when I'm in a conflict.
If you're a visual thinker, this is like wearing a suit of armor at the beach. Really good if you're fighting somebody off. Really challenging to enjoy.
Yeah. Okay, that'll keep it off. All right. So this is the instinctual stuff, right? We can't do anything about this. Our body is primed to take on conflict, and that's okay. We get the surge of adrenaline, but now we have to decide, what are we going to do about it? So, now we're in this middle ground where our bodies are primed towards a certain reaction, but that's reinforced by nurture. Okay, so fight, flight, or freeze, that's half that we're primed towards fight, flight, or freeze, but we really reinforce that through our own behaviors. That can be changed later. So that's a little cliffhanger of what's to come. I know you're excited. Okay, first one, fight. We all know fight, right? Fight is the person that says, cougar's coming, I got this. This is gonna be good. Okay, and he picks up bag of salt in the wagon and he goes after the cougar, okay? They're the ones that are like, I am ready. my darling husband, again, love him. But whenever I bring up something like the garbage, he's like, oh yeah, let's talk about this. Okay, he's excited. He's into it. He wants to have that conversation. That's engaging and exciting for him. He gets that adrenaline rush, right? He's the fighter. Important to have those kinds of people. As we're going through this presentation, I don't want to imply that there's a certain type that's good or bad, or that the nature side of you is bad and needs to be subdued and we need to be logical. They're all good pieces. Our bodies are really designed well. We're just trying to give you knowledge right now about what's going on so you can have the best skills to be in control of conflict as you get there. So, number one, fight. Good to have these people. They're the ones that are policy changers. They're the visionaries. They're the ones that see something wrong and they fix it. Flight. These are the people that when the conflict cougar comes, they say, grab the kids, grab the bag of salt, let's run. Okay? And it's important to have those kinds of people too, right? They're the ones that say, boy, this conflict is just not worth it right now. I'm gonna duck out the door. I'm gonna take a break, let things cool down. Freeze. This is becoming a much more common type of reaction. So they're finding out that a lot of people freeze if they've had some kind of difficult trauma in the past, or if they've, whenever they have had conflict experiences, it just hasn't gone well. And so instead of trying to fight the cougar, or instead of trying to run away from the cougar, they are playing dead. Okay? They're trying that on for a reaction to see if that's getting them what they want. Freeze is often me. That's typically what I do. I don't know if it's because I've had a big trauma or if it's just because I'm not a fighter and I don't want to run away. I just don't know what to do in conflict. And so I'm just kind of this person that sits there. And again, we're seeing this reaction more and more often. Think about if you're at a soccer game and a little kid missed the goal. And you see his dad come over to him, or his mom, or whomever. You see his parent come over to him and say, what's wrong with you? How could you miss that goal? That was such an easy goal. I am so embarrassed. I did not raise you like this. Look me in the eyes when I'm talking to you. And what does the kid do? The kid goes deeper and deeper and deeper within himself, right? The kid just hides, and the kid withdraws. And the reason for that is that their reaction is to freeze. They can't fight their parent. They can't run away from their parent, so their only option there is just to freeze. And then the really sad part, you might need to help me with the physiology of this. Okay, the really sad part is the more they feel attacked and the more they are asked to buck up and look their parent in the eye, the more their body tells them to hide and withdraw until it gets to the point that they're bagel. All right, turn around. You demonstrate.
There's a whole bunch of, great. Anybody have anatomy and physiology experience? Okay, so there's a reaction in the body. Anybody ever stood up really fast and felt like you might go? That's a vasovagal reaction. So super complex physiology in the body. But there are times where we get to the point, especially in a trauma, where there is no way to escape. There is no way to fight. And we see this a lot with kids. It's also called learned helplessness, if you've heard of the on that. And what we see when we do the research with these little guys, and sometimes with adults, is that they can actually have this little maybe vasovagal response, which is they get flooded with this adrenaline, and almost, they don't pass out, but they almost physically kind of sink down. And they'll have a musculature relaxed. They have the opposite of what's going on here. Instead of becoming hyperaware of what's out, they go way in, and they tend to agree. That can happen with adults. But when we have kids who have this reaction a lot as children, they grow up to be adults who cannot tolerate conflict. And it's very physiological, but we're not recognizing that a lot of the times when we're helping adults manage conflict. So later in the presentation, we're going to talk about how to help everyone in this room and then how to help you help the people you work with, supervise, teach, recognize when those physiological reactions are happening. So that you know that that's what it is, you can name it and then you can change it. Yeah. Does that work?
Perfect.
Okay. Do you want your performing?
No, not yet. Yeah.
So when somebody is freezing, they are literally not able to look them up in the eye. Their nerves are programming them so much and trying so hard to protect them that the louder you scream, look me in the eye, they can't. It just breaks my heart when you see that. So that's a little bit about what's going on with freeze. What's going on with fight or flight as it relates to conflict is these guys, like you said, the opposite is happening if you're in fight or flight mode, in that you have this rush of adrenaline, that your body is giving you lots more blood and oxygen to go do stuff. Fight or flight, you'll notice it's as if time for them slows down, and suddenly they are able to have almost perfect recall of a conversation. And they're in this place where they're excited, they're enjoying it, and they can repeat back to you, fact for fact, every little thing you said. Whereas the freeze people, the opposite's happening, and things get muddled. And it's like, it just feels like time is going too fast for them, and they can't quite keep up. And they're having they're not getting enough blood and oxygen, and so they cannot recall the details. And it's so frustrating to have an argument between somebody who's in fight mode and somebody who's in freeze mode, because the fight person is saying, don't you remember when blah, 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 blah. And the freeze person is saying, I'm pretty sure that what you said was, I can't quite remember what you said, but I know it wasn't quite that, right? Have you guys seen that kind of an interaction where it's just, there's two people that are not connecting. They have different responses. All right. So I'm sure that everybody has done this before, so I apologize if this is review. However, hand in the ear, tuck in your thumb, and then put the top down. Okay, so this is our little image of our brain. Most of you have done this before, right? Okay, so the two parts that I really want to look at are your amygdala. We'll say there's another. Your amygdala and your prefrontal cortex. All right? So your prefrontal cortex, what's amazing about this is how well it can remember the past and look towards the future. So it can remember things that really worked well in the past and grab those habits and apply them towards future decisions. Okay? When you're having a conversation with somebody, if you want it to go well and you want them to make logical decisions, you want them to be operating out of their prefrontal cortex. However, if they start to get super flooded, and they start to get super attacked, and they feel like this conflict cougar is just about to attack them, then finally the amygdala goes, whoa, we've got to, it's martial law time. I'm stepping in. Do you want to? Yeah, let's do this. Okay. Prefrontal cortex, able to make logical decisions that relate to the past and has implications for the future, not logical. So this is our amygdala that's taken over and says, cougar, things are happening. What are we going to do? So when your prefrontal cortex is no longer the primary one in control, right when your amygdala is taking over. And that's when you're in fight, flight, or freeze mode. That's when you are no longer, this is the key here, that's when you are no longer making the kinds of decisions you want for the long-term outcome you want. Might feel really good short term. You know, picking up the garbage and dumping it on him on the couch. Oh, that would feel so good short term. Long term might not get me the kind of outcome that I want, though, right? Yeah, do you know who knows Phineas Gage?
Oh, nobody knows my buddy Phineas Gage?
Okay.
Yeah, the Tampa Niner. So, early 1900s, they're building a railroad. Metal iron and stamping it. Stamping iron sounds really smart, right? Smashing it in there so that it can blow a little hole later on when they light it. Only problem with Phineas is something went wrong. Stamping iron goes down, stamping iron comes back up, through his eye, through his prefrontal cortex, and out the other side. But he lives.
Yeah.
Phineas Gage was an upstanding, family friendly, never swore, church-going kind of guy. He turned into an obsessive gambler. He Or like a sailor. Sorry if I offended the sailor. And he had a really hard time being successful in life, even though nothing else in his brain changed. He just lost the ability to let his prefrontal cortex drive the car. It was still there, but his amygdala and his other systems were now sitting in the front seat. What was left of his executive center, the control center, the command center in the brain, anybody seen Inside Out? Yeah. There you go. Control center was offline. So this picture is great because we need the amygdala. We have to have it, otherwise we'd all be walking around, you know, we'd be a planet of only Spock, and we can't have only Spock. But the amygdala really should only drive for a very short amount of time for Phineas, if you ever want to see it, it's on display in New York, his skull, and the tempe. Yeah. If you're a nerd, like me. There we go.
Okay, so I mentioned there were three stages, right? There was the initial, we recognize that there's a conflict, then we react to conflict, and again, that reaction is kind of half nature, half nurture, and now we're on to choosing our role. Again, we might be predisposed one way or another, but roles, that's pretty much nurture, all right? So what's good about that is it means we can also change our role. All right. So, Princess and Dragon, there are a lot of different terms for these. I stole these from Ken Klug's Behaving Dangerously. I think these to me are the terms that describe the different roles we take the best. So if you want to read more about this or just learn more about anything in general with conflict, read Ken Klug. It's just amazing.
I'm sorry, can you say the name?
Yes. C-L-O... Ken Cloak. Yeah, incredible. All right, Prince, Princess, Dragon. So the prince, best way to describe this, let's say you're at the office, and you and your team have really been wrestling on how to get this project finished. And there are a couple little pieces that you need to finalize, and you decided that you're just going to sleep on it for the night. You guys will all meet back in the morning and then figure out what to do. So you're all taking off when the prince says, oh my gosh, I can't believe this. You guys are taking so long, you drive me nuts. You know what, forget it. I'm just going to take it. I'll submit it. At least I can get something done. Okay? And then hands it in. And look at me, what a wonderful person. I am the prince. I saved the day. Aren't you guys lucky that I am here? Does anybody know those kinds of people? Is it just me? So they look really good, right? They've got the crown, and they've got the white steed, and they're rushing in. But what happens? You see this beautiful white steed, but then you see this huge chaos in their wake, right? They've just destroyed all these relationships, and they're causing all kinds of conflict because they have no patience for the people around them, because they are frustrated with the people around them, and because their response to conflict is just to fight through it. I'm not going to take the time to talk. I'm just going to... just kind of push through it. Okay, so that's the prince. Princess. The princess is the person who says, yes, I know that the project was due today, but what you don't understand is that, Leslie didn't give me her notes until late last night, and I had a soccer game to go to, and because you had this other project that you wanted me to get done by yesterday, I didn't have any time to work on the project, and so I would love to have turned it in to you, but really, you should talk to Leslie about her time management skills. Okay? The princess is the one who never manages to take responsibility, who always seems to be the victim, and is really good at playing that victim role. Dragon. The dragon is the one who says, all right, prince wants to jump in and grab my spotlight. Princess wants to make sure that she's not taking on her share of it. Fine. Screw it. Next time, I'll show them who's in charge of this project. Okay, they're the one that kind of has that, I'm done. I am done being patient. I am done trying to collaborate. That's not working for me anymore. I just want to go and kind of stick it to them. Okay? I don't know about you guys, but I can definitely think of a time where I have been every one of these people. I wish I hadn't, but it's easy to go there. It's after I heard this and I started being aware of the roles that people often take in conversations, it's really funny now to listen to other people tell their story, and they kind of always tell it from one of these points of view, right? Where they were the hero or the victim or, I stuck it to that landlord who wouldn't give me my security deposit. Man, I called the Better Business Bureau and he will never have a tenant again, right? You start to hear these roles that people take down their story. Okay.
Chip, can I ask you for help? Would you take the law? Where you are. Leslie, would you come with me?
This room.
Yes. Okay. Chip, if you wouldn't mind, just tell us what you see.
Brown wood.
Good job. Leslie, can you tell us what you see?
I see lots of people and color and doorway and tables and candy.
Perfect.
Light.
Perfect. Thank you.
Very nice.
All right. When we are in conflict, the problem is we begin to have kind of a myopic view of conflict. Suddenly, that one thing that's important to us becomes important to the exclusion of everything else. So we are so focused on that one thing we need that we forget if we turn around and step out of our conflict for a second, we actually have access to all of these resources. We have all of these options that would satisfy our interest. All right? So what we're going to talk about now is how to move from the prince, princess, and dragon role that feels so good back into where we really want to go, where we are making long-term decisions that will really satisfy what started the conflict in the first place, all right? So to get there, we have to move from this external focus, right, from where I'm the prince, princess, or dragon, and I'm attacking my husband to not garbage, okay? That's the external focus. That's the role that we've chosen. We have to go back down to internal. How did we react? Did we fight, flight, or freeze? We have to go even more back down to the value. So that's what initially caused the conflict, what bothered me. And so if we were going to look at the garbage example, if I were just operating out of my external focus, then I would take on the role of the dragon, say, oh yeah, you're not going to take out the garbage? Guess who's not making dinner? Okay, that's the dragon role. If I were to just take an internal where I'm just reacting to it, then I would probably just freeze. I would just say, well, I thought we were in this together. I thought that we had a shared division of roles here where you took out the garbage and I made dinner. I don't know what to do. I wouldn't talk to him about it. I wouldn't get anything done for myself. I'm just frozen. So neither of those are helpful. I need to go back to the very beginning, okay, what actually started the conflict, and look at the value. Why did this escalate for me? Why does it bug me so much? It's just garbage, for goodness sake. But to me, it's a sign that I don't feel loved. I don't feel respected. I don't feel like there's a shared division of labor there. I don't feel like when times get tough and there's so much going on and I'm overwhelmed, that he's going to be there to help support me and pick up his share of the load. Okay, that's what's going on. Yeah, again, I know it's just garbage, but it's very loaded garbage to me. It represents a lot. So if we want to actually make progress in conflict, what we have to do is move from the role that we took back down to, okay, how did I react to that role, back to the very center of what is it there? What's that value? What bugged me so much? What's that initial piece of the conflict that I need to deal with? Because I don't know about you guys, but trying to solve a conflict as a prince, princess, or dragon never works out. Never really gets you what you want. And I keep trying. I keep trying to push through as the dragon or save the day as the prince or poor me as the princess. But it never, it never
never gets you where you need to go. Have you ever been, here's a good example. Have you ever been in a grocery store and there's that mom, we'll pretend it's not me, we'll pretend it's somebody else, with crazy kids that are just done. And they have been shopping all day long and they're just done. And they are whining and they are crying and they are exhausted and they are just at the end of their rope. And the mom is just trying to like, come on, shut up, just 5 more minutes and we'll be home, right? And she's just trying to push with her own strength to get what she wants. And then, have you ever seen those moms that instead say, okay, we're going to take a break. I'm going to take a couple minutes. I'm going to come down here and talk to you. Thank you so much for how patient you've been today. It's just been incredible. Why don't we pause? Let's just do a walk around the store. Maybe we can pick up a banana and get you something to eat, okay? And then on the way home, let's go to the park. Does that sound good? So what the mom does there is instead of trying to push things through as the dragon or the prince and continue to push through in her own role, she pauses, goes back to the heart of the conflict, addresses the humanity in the other person, so she's able to see what's going on, she's able to understand the conflict that's really going on there, and she's able to get what she wants. So that's what we're going to talk about. How do you, instead of trying to push through in your role and try to solve the conflict on your own, how do you get back down to the interest? How do you get back down to the value that really caused it? So, that being said, it's not easy to do. Because like we initially talked about, your eyes, your ears, your brain, everything is primed towards, there's a conflict, defend yourself, we have to take care of you. So it's not easy, which is good, because if it were easy, I wouldn't have a job. So it's okay that there's this little struggle with conflict, and that it does take some time to figure out how do we move from these positions of prince, princess, and dragon, how do we move from those roles to figuring out what the real interest is. So the first one, neuroplasticity. People have heard of this term? Okay. When I first heard this term, it didn't make any sense to me. Because the idea there is that our brains... remember the conflict path we talked about in the beginning? The idea is that our brains have ruts that they like to go down. And again, some of those ruts are predisposed. Some of it is just that over time, we develop certain habits, and those habits reinforce the same habits. And so just like the Conestoga wagons digging in those Oregon Trail ruts, our brains have the same ruts going through them, right? So we are predisposed to continue to get upset about the same thing. The garbage bugs me. Always going to bug me. There are certain ruts that will always bother me. And my brain is predisposed to always have that same response to that type of conflict. This makes sense so far, right? Okay. So, the idea behind neuroplasticity is that our brains are actually not as stuck in the same rut as we thought. Our brains are actually kind of trainable. We can change how we begin to respond toward conflict. Again, we might not change our initial reaction, but we can really change whether or not we take on a role, whether or not we jump into a position, or whether our initial response is to be collaborative. So the reason this didn't make sense to me initially is because to me, plastic is not, you can't change that, right? It's not like it's called Nero paper. This moves, I get this. This doesn't make sense to me. So when we were freshmen, Leslie's parents bought her this big, beautiful red plastic bowl that she bought out to college. You might notice it's not here today. The reason for that is because Leslie and I decided to fry donuts at like midnight. And then we realized we had to clean out the pan. And we've never run a kitchen before. Our parents had done all that stuff. And so I said, well, let's just pour the oil in the pot, in that big plastic red pot. And Leslie says, I don't think that's a good idea. I said, no, it's fine. It's plastic, it's okay. So I poured the hot oil in. And we're
over here and we're cleaning it. And then Leslie goes, there's oil all over our counter and our carpet. So what had happened, I know this now, plastic can melt. With enough heat and pressure applied to it, it began to rearrange the plastic, and then the oil drips down. Sorry. Yeah. So that's the idea behind neuroplasticity, is that yes, our brains are tough. Our brains are molded in a certain fashion. However, if you begin to apply enough force, okay, if you begin to apply a little bit of pressure and begin to force your brain to think another way, then you can actually mold it. You can reshape some of those ruts. So that, from now on, when I think about the garbage, instead of letting myself, I can start to say, okay, Claire, it's just garbage. You know he loves you. You know everything is fine. Just see it as garbage. Recognize he needs to have some downtime when he comes home. Why don't you give him that space and just ask if he could do the garbage tomorrow, right? So I can start to retrain my brain, and then it's still a bump for me, but it doesn't need to be Mount Everest anymore, right? I can start to say, okay, could we have a conversation about this? Because it's kind of bothering me. I would like to come up with a better plan for how we divide up the roles. Okay, I can have a conversation where I'm more in control instead of letting these roles just take over me and I don't get the outcome.
Not so long ago, many scientists believed that the brains did not change after childhood, that it was hardwired and fixed by the time we became adults. But recent events in only the last decade now tell us that this is simply not true. The brain can and does change throughout our lives. It is adaptable, like plastic. Engineering scientists call this neuroplasticity. How does neuroplasticity work? If you think of the brain as a dynamic, connected hybrid, there are billions of pathways or rows lining up every time we think, feel, or do something. Some of these rows are well-traveled. These are our habits, our established ways of thinking, feeling, and doing. Every time we think in a certain way, practice a particular task, or feel a specific emotion, we strengthen this road. It becomes easier for our brains to travel this pathway. So we think about something differently, learning a new task, or choose a different emotion. We start traveling on a new road. If we keep traveling that road, our brains begin to use this pathway more, and this new way of thinking, feeling, or doing becomes second nature. The old pathway gets used less and less and weakens. This process of rewiring the brain by forming new connections and weakening old ones is neuroplasticity in action. The good news is that we all have the ability to learn and change by rewiring our brains. If you have ever changed a bad habit or thought about something differently, you have carved a new pathway in your brain and experienced neuroplasticity firsthand. With repeated and directed attention towards your desired change, you can rewire your brain.
And that goes back to death. It's the fifth user loser. I don't know how many times I heard that growing up. None of that was true. But it's really difficult. So
one of the ways that you can help your brain change how it responds to conflict is this idea of window of tolerance. And again, I'm saying everything to you. I'm not implying that you guys are the only ones with conflict here, but I'm hoping to give you some tools that you guys can take back to your constituents, to your office, and change how you respond to conflict, but also have tools that will help those around you, how they respond to conflict. Okay, so this is one of those tools that's really good to bring back to your office. It's called the window of tolerance. All right. This is my window of tolerance. If something happens and it's within this window, oh, by the way, the woman who really discusses this, her name is Sarah Payton. Has anybody heard of her? She's amazing. It's not Sarah Palin. She has a degree in neurobiology from UCLA, and then she became a mediator, so it's fantastic because she has this great neurobiology background, but she applies those concepts towards conflict. So, fascinating woman, excellent speaker. Therapy. So she discusses this window of tolerance that says, if something happens, I might not like it, but if it's within my window of tolerance, I can still operate, I can still get what I want out of it. I don't have to, my amygdala isn't going to take over and push me into martial law. I might still be upset. I'm not going to be pushed into one of those roles where I feel like I have to take on the prince or princess or dragon, but I feel comfortable enough with this that I can operate from myself. I can operate out of my values and communicate what I really want long-term out of this conflict. However, if something happens outside of my window of tolerance, that's when I'm, right? That's when the purple minion takes over and I just don't know how to respond. So, let's pretend you're driving down the street and suddenly you see the lights flashing behind you and you hear the whoo, whoo. Okay? And if you're like me, you also hear the da-da. And you feel like it's this great white coming to get you. So I remember a few years ago, one of the first times I was pulled over and the lights are flashing. I don't get pulled over all the time. Just so I was pulled over and I lost it. It was so outside of my window of tolerance. These scenarios are going through my head like, I don't even think I have my driver's license. I'm probably going to go to jail. What's going to happen when I'm in jail? Right? I'm not thinking clearly. So it's outside of my window of tolerance, and I am flooded. I am bawling. I'm a wreck and not able to communicate in any logical way. I mean, the poor police officer comes up, and he's like, ma'am, you have a busted taillight. Ma'am. It was awful. However, it ended up being a positive experience, right? Because he's kind of laughing at me, like, are you okay? Do I need to call somebody for you? And it's gonna be fine. I just need to sit here and go to bed. It's fine. So it ended up being okay. So, okay, the next time I got pulled over, I didn't flip out. I didn't like it. It was uncomfortable. However, my window of tolerance had expanded. And so this difficult experience was now tolerable. Not likable, but it was tolerable. So I was able to get through it having a logical conversation. I was able to speak with the cop and get out of the situation what I needed, get the information that I needed, remember where my license was, all that kind of stuff. Because I was able to think logically, I was able to operate from my prefrontal cortex, so I was able to remember in the past, this went well. In the future, I am not going to go to jail. It's okay. And so my prefrontal cortex was able to stay engaged and in control and remind me, okay, Claire, you're going to get through this all right. All right? So that's the idea behind the window of tolerance. So what happened there to make my window expand? Only two things, okay? Number one, positive. I had a positive prior experience that made this go okay. Now, even if it hadn't been an actual experience that happened to me, but I remembered Leslie telling me about a funny story where a cop pulled her over and everything was fine, or I'd recently, seen a movie or I'd been able to visualize it or something, it could still have that same type of calming effect. So it needs to be a positive experience. Better, more effective if it's happened to you, but not even necessary. Okay, so it could have been a shared conversation with a friend. So number one, positive. This is why the whole idea of visualization, that's why that's so powerful. It really does work. It helps your brain go, nope, I can stay engaged. I'm not going to totally freak out. I'm not going into purple minion, amygdala is ruling my life stage. I'm going to stay in control through this, right? Visualization really does work, and this is why. So the second thing that happened I named it. I was able to tell myself, okay, Claire, you don't like this. This is uncomfortable, but that's okay. I was able to name the thing that really happened to me so that my
ache so that my brain felt validated. My brain said, wait, this is a difficult experience. And I could say, I know this is very uncomfortable, but that's okay. So it's the idea in mediation where we reframe something. So if a parent comes into a meeting and is just out of control saying, we had agreed on this. We had agreed that you were going to keep my child in a general classroom, and now suddenly you're coming up with this plan where my kid has to be shoved off to another classroom, special ed classroom again for the rest of his life. Are you kidding me? We had a plan. Now what happens if you tell the parent, you're fine, everything's okay, it's going to work out? What's the parent going to do? Okay, that's fine. No, they're going to flip out, right? They're already in their, dragon position, and they're going to go even farther into their dragon position. They're mad. The only way that we can help to relate to that, the only way we can hope to relate to that parent is by naming it, by showing them, hey, I get what you're going through. You really feel betrayed right now, and I understand, and I'm sorry that you feel that way. Let me show you the reason why we made this decision, and then see what you think, okay? So by naming it, by saying, I get that you feel betrayed. I understand why this was so difficult. That's how we're able to say, the brain is able to say, okay, they get it. I feel betrayed, I don't like it, but they understand. So this is tolerable. So I think Liz is going to talk about this a little bit more. So what happens there is I've moved from the person who's experiencing it to I'm more observing it. I'm saying, okay, here's the situation. Clara got pulled over, she doesn't like it, but it's going to be okay. All right, so instead of me feeling like, everything's happening to me, I can kind of step out and say, no, Claire, remember, you've been through this before. It's just a cop. Try not to snot all over his sleeve this time. It's going to be okay. All right, so that's the idea behind window of tolerance, that one of the ways we can change our brain is by talking about a positive experience and by naming it. Again, this works really well. This is one of those things that you want to bring back to your offices, to clients, to parents that you work with, positive and naming it. Right, when you see somebody that's just about to go offline. Okay. Finally, one of the final ways that you can help to change your brain or change somebody else's brain is by, I say, pleasure over anger. You know the term newlywed stage, right? That's that lovey-dovey, everything's fine, and we just got married, and everything's great. Let's just think logically for a second. You take two people from drastically different backgrounds, one of whom expects the trash taken out and the other one doesn't, and you shove them into the same house. They're not going to get along initially, okay? It takes a long time for that to happen. So the newlywed stage, I think, comes about because, let's say you shove them into the same house, 9 months later, you have this little bundle of joy that comes out, okay? So, when people are fighting and they're upset and there's conflict going on, there's this other part of the brain that wants to recognize the joy and the beauty of this wonderful little baby. And I think that's what the newlywed stage is really coming from. Because anger is one of those emotions that's over here on this side of the brain. Pleasure, joy, creativity, those all come from the exact opposite side of the brain. The brain cannot produce chemicals to sustain both at the exact same time. It has to make a choice. So when you are fighting with your spouse and you're all upset, and then suddenly this little baby coos, your brain has to make a choice. Do I want to continue this fighting, or do I go, little baby? Okay, so how does this apply in meetings? Leslie is saying that when she's having what's going to be a difficult conversation with parents, she asks them to bring a video of the kids. So that when they're all worked up, you can pause, you can see a video of the children, and then you have to choose. Am I going to hold on to my anger, or am I going to go back to what's more important and let my brain start to create those chemicals that will allow me to appreciate my child, which will lead towards creativity and collaboration and get what I want? Some other examples of this are, mainly what's happening here is you want the person to feel a little bit more grounded. So there are some other techniques. Well, again, this is one of the things we'll talk about at the end, but some other techniques for feeling grounded are, you're in a meeting with somebody and they're all worked up, take a walk, go outside, look out the window, have a cup of tea. Do those kinds of things that give people pleasure
so that they can, so that their brain has to make the decision of, do I really want to hold on to this anger? Or, gosh, this tea tastes really good. I'm going to let go of some of the anger so I can appreciate the pleasure of the tea. All right, we've got one more. So, the whole point of this last hour, yes, our brains are wired to sustain conflict. However, by understanding why we are in conflict, we can actually move towards a place of understanding. So some of the ways we move towards that place of understanding are recognizing that we can tolerate it so our brains don't flip out, taking a moment to appreciate some kind of a beauty, a grounding technique so we can get ourselves out of the conflict. And then these are some of the other techniques that we'll talk about in the second half. By learning how to collaborate with the other person, by feeling like things are fair, like there's a balance of power. So having some of these in place will help to prevent the conflict from happening or help us to get us out of conflict in the first place. Okay, so this is your little preview of what's about to come. And I think, yep. So now, so we're just about to take a break, but first, I know I just did a major crash course in your brain on conflict. Does anybody have any questions?
Yes.
It could be that they have just had so many negative experiences with that in the past and it just always goes badly. So they just have a deep rut that says, I recognize the situation, bam. I am completely escalated instantly.
The window is one way to look at it, and I would agree that you can view it as the window is very small. There's another thing we're going to talk about in a minute that was actually developed for kids on the autism spectrum, it's a thermometer. The same theory, but it's looking at high and low versus big and small. And I would say those two concepts working in concert with one another, and they'll apply in different situations.
Well, and maybe not just parents, in my opinion, just people in general.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes, all
of
us.
Yeah.
Sure, you're the one who sees the garbage that way. Mm-hmm. So you actually are the creator of the
situation.
While
true.
They're
for
garbage.
Right.
And it's just
true.
Yeah, systems have a window.
Yeah, yeah. Special education system has a window.
Yeah.
The Senate of the United States has a window. So, I mean, this goes micro all the way to macro.
And it's important to note that what looks like conflict to me is not the same for everybody.
If you have conflict creators.
Right.
That's what I call them.
You know, right.
Like, or people that are totally unaware of their conflict. And all of a sudden, it's like, wow, I didn't know. So I was just kind of like,
So I mediate, that's mostly what I do. And I often have to check in with people and say, boy, your voices are raised, your cheeks are red, you guys are swearing at each other. This is high for me. This is an extreme level of conflict. I feel like I need to take a break. And they're like, what? I'm not talking, it's good. Yeah. So it's important to check in with people because it might be totally tolerable for them. Right. Leslie's going to talk about, and that I really don't mean to imply that we want to crush down our amygdala and only operate from this logical
place, because that's not always wise. Because sometimes our amygdala is raising red flags for a really good reason. Robert Benjamin up in Portland gave this fantastic story about he hurt his knee. And he'd been on the couch for 2 weeks, and then he went into his doctor's appointment and knew he'd kind of been moving around and going upstairs. So he took some of his oxycodone and then went to the office. And the doctor said, "Does it hurt?" He said, "No! This is great! I feel good!" Yeah. And then went home and went, "Oh crap, this really hurts. I made everything so nice and soft that I wasn't listening to my body's warning signals that says, no, something's really wrong." So our amygdala is, like you said, our amygdala is often telling us that something's wrong. Our amygdala is the one that raises the red flags and says, no, you really need to pay attention. There is a value here that's beginning to be betrayed. You need to pay attention to this. And so the point there is to realize that, yes, this is uncomfortable and this is bad, but I need somehow to keep this in my window of tolerance so I don't lose it.
I just had a show that I've known with Jesus, but he's an adult now, so I know it's called the Great Great Experience. In the mediation session, I had Mike Ball come on, and I was with him as a child, and he taught me the difference between fighting and advocating. Because the children were going to come and taught me how to fight for our children. And so when I was in the mediation session, I came in and said, you know, I just got my child support from a psychologist, and he said, I need to come here and fight for it. I actually felt my body had a reaction. It reminded me of what it used to feel like when my child was younger, and I thought I had to fight all the time. And I really went into a fetal position.
Yeah.
I was tired, I was exhausted. And so with parents now, I try to work with them to make it a piece of that fine line between fighting, which creates conflict as soon as you walk in the door, which is advocating, which is more of a relationship building for us. And I can feel it in myself.
Did you guys hear that? Just the idea that instead of fighting for something, that you want to be advocating for it.
And that, so the neurology of that is that if the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex are in concert, that's advocacy. Because amygdala is going to give us signals. I don't like what you said right there. It's a tone. Prefrontal cortex says, write that down, address that when it's appropriate, don't drag in the meeting. So if you think about it as a vehicle, amygdala is driving or fighting. Amygdala is non-existent or freezing or fleeing. And when they're in concert and we're using our physiology and our neurology as information, well, we allow our executive function, our planning, our self-inhibition, our self-monitoring, then we advocate for our kids and for ourselves and for our systems. And that's the whole second half of what we're going to talk about is applying this with neurology to what we do on an everyday basis. So how, what are we going to do when we leave here? How we can change the lives of kids and adults.
Are you going to do the visual?
Yeah.
Okay, get ready.
That's going to be great.
All right, so it is. Yeah. So it's, can we plan on being back here at 11? Does that work?
Okay. Your hand needs to stand up.
everybody back? Are we okay on time?
Yeah.
Ready to start?
Yes.
Okay, we're going to talk a little neuroscience, but we're going to really apply it to special ed from the base up. Can you all hear me okay? Loud. So we're going to use neuroscience, but if anybody has had neurophysiology or neurology classes, please try not to ding me. These are gross generalizations. So when in the minute it talks about your hippocampus shrinks in volume, doesn't actually shrink in your head and grow. If you have questions on the neurology, we can talk about it a little bit later. So we're going to start with some of the objectives and then the drawbacks of SPED in general, because we need to talk about that. So anybody who works in special education knows that really what we're doing is we're trying to identify the needs of students, generate a team that is aware of the needs of students and the strengths, develop appropriate accommodations and treatments. We want to establish consensus. That's a huge one for everybody in this room. And we want to follow that all the way through to deliver effective services that lead to growth and change. That's why everybody's here. What is the drawback, though? It's inherently full of conflict. And my shoe is stuck in my hand. What we're doing is bringing together multiple professionals with different stakes, different investments, because a child needs something. There isn't anything, in my opinion, more inherently laden with conflict than helping kids who need help. If it's not managed well, the SPED process really can create this us and them phenomenon, which I'm sure everybody in here has experienced. And if you're not in special education specifically in other areas of your life, there's a big mismatch often in emotional versus intellectual investment. So when I'm the vice principal, I have a way different investment than when I'm mom or when I'm dad or when I'm the child's teacher. The SPED process assumes a level of background knowledge in multiple fields. Nobody in there is an expert in the law and in mediation and in the psychology of the child and in the school system in which that nobody can do all that. And if you can, I want your number. And then everybody has aspirational desires. And whether we like it or not, they are constricted by realism because money exists and budgets exist, even if we don't want them to. Okay. We're going to talk a little bit of neuroscience. We're going to go back to talking about the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex, but even a little deeper into the chemicals. Nope, we're not. We're going to go back. And I'm going to click it.
Stress. Never a good thing. Or is it? Actually, neuroscience over the last 20 years has shown that stress doesn't always reduce our performance. In fact, at the right levels, it could be rather good for it. Let's look closer. First of all, yes, excessive stress has a negative impact on the brain and the body. It's a double whammy, as stress impacts specific areas of the brain when we need them most. The hippocampus, crucial to learning and memory, and the amygdala, responsible for emotion. Here's how it works. Under stress, areas flood with cortisol, the stress hormone. Say you have to present to the board and you get stressed. As your cortisol level goes up, the physical volume of the hippocampus goes down, so you forget things under pressure. At the same time, as more cortisol floods the amygdala, the more active it becomes, so you become more emotional at the same time. As we said, a double whammy. Yet the theory that stress can be both good and bad goes back to 1908. And two scientists, Yerkes and Dodson, they developed a theory they called the inverted U. They recognized people underperformed at high levels of stress, but also at low levels of stress, when there was insufficient motivation and arousal to perform well. Anxiety at one end, but apathy at the other. Work by Csikszentmihalyi in 97 and Amy Arnston in 98 sheds more light. In particular, Arnston's biology of being fuzzled found stress also affects our levels of two key neurochemicals, dopamine and norepinephrine. The prefrontal cortex, responsible for executive functioning like planning and emotional control, depends on having the right balance of these two chemicals. When we're tired or bored, levels of DA and NE in our system go down. The balance is tipped, leading to apathy and underperformance. On the flip side, when we experience uncontrollable stress, there's massive toxic release of NE and DA, leading to anxiety, lower control, and higher emotion. Csikszentmihalyi sums these states up in zones. The drone zone at one end, the panic zone at the other, the flow zone in the middle. That's where you want to be. So what does it all mean for leaders? The key is you staying in the flow zone and getting your team to do the same. Here are three ways to start. First, think about how your actions may be contributing to the stress of others. In particular, think about the atmosphere you create in meetings, interviews, and other potentially stressful situations. It's probably unintentional, but even being in the room might make more of an impact than you know to people junior to you. So be sensitive to it, and also have strategies to create a good atmosphere in those environments. Second, think about the level of challenge you're giving people, and most importantly, how they perceive those challenges. Key to keeping your team in the flow zone is balancing a person's perceived challenge with their own perceived ability. And finally, remember stress is a state, not a character trait. Csikszentmihalyi found that people who experience flow are more likely to be able to recreate it and become better at maintaining this balance once they know what it feels like. So help your team understand the triggers which trip them out of flow or into it. And then practice, because practice makes perfect.
Make sense? If you go to the link for our presentation after this, this is a link. You can follow this to an incredible set of tools. This is specifically geared towards leaders. So when you lead a team, how to apply this. This is all window of tolerance. This is all Prince, Princess, Dragon. It's the same thing. We're just talking about it now at a more neurochemical level and not so macro. I'm going to give you a quick example before we move on. So that flow zone, this stuff right up here. I have to use this because I've never used it before ever in any presentation. Do that. That's amazing. This one. So here's Mrs. Fowler. She has five kids. Four of them are autistic. Four of them are autistic. She's come from her second job. She is late for her IEP meeting. She sits down. And we all say, welcome to the meeting. We've already introduced ourselves. You're really kind of late. What is it that you want to have on your child's IEP? I've heard that in countless IEP meetings. What are you asking for? There's no way. The demand of that is way too high. You're automatically going to have someone who's fighting, freezing, or trying to run away. So just something to keep. You gotta have a good cat meme. This guy is about to experience fight or flight. In 3, 2, 1, see the guy. So common triggers. The fight or flight reaction is intentionally in our body, not supposed to be triggered by I stepped on a rock, right? Unless it's a really big rock. It's strong emotion, usually fear. It's vast majority of time it's fear, but not always. Sometimes anger or anxiety. Direct threats will do it. I'm going to punch you in the face. That'll trigger it. But implied threats will too, including loss of resources. Mrs. Fowler, you know, you didn't respond even though you got your prior written notice a whole 12 hours before the meeting. You didn't respond, so we had it without you. She's going to be in fight or flight. And we saw the loss of resources with our little friend, the monkey, who does not enjoy cucumbers. And then intimidation. Intimidation does not have to be direct. Mrs. Fowler walks in, and there is a long, skinny table with 15 professionals, and at the other end of the table is her. Anybody seen the research on the power seat? Where you sit in meetings just by sitting tells everybody what your role is, what your job is. Every IEP meeting should have a round table, in my opinion. That we, by the way, we specifically asked for round tables. They didn't get round tables. We got round tables.
So intimidation does not have to be on the conscious level. That's why we're teaching you this stuff today, or reinforcing things that you already know, perhaps. Because if you're not aware that you're doing it, or even are intimidating, you can't change it. You can't do anything about it. So we're going to talk about short-term stress versus long-term. Short-term stress is okay. One zombie, you need short-term stress. The amygdala will help you figure out a quick plan that's efficient to kill the zombie. Zombie apocalypse, not going to happen. You're eventually going to flood, right? One IEP meeting, fine. 10 years of IEP meetings, you can be flooded. I've been talking about parents. Let's say you're a facilitator, and you're really great at your job, but you're not that great at regulating your own reactions. So you get really flooded. Every meeting, you're leaving feeling depleted. One meeting like that, you're okay. 10, you're going to quit your job and do something else. You're not going to be able to use your resources. So short-term, okay. Long-term, not okay. There are some things we cannot change and can change. I work a lot with kids, which is why I'm a little silly and I have cat names and I'm loud. I have two different size hula hoops that I use with kids, and I'll have them stand inside the second one. And then we'll write down all the things they're worried about in life. Everything. Inside the outer loop, we work together to place all the cards of the things they cannot control. And then we work on how to release those. And on the inner loop, we teach them to put all the things that they can control, including their own reaction. And then sometimes, when kids are really stressed in school, I tell them, put your hula hoop up. Is it in it or out of it? But we can do that internally. Some of the things we can't change are that we may have prior trauma, or our clients or parents may have prior trauma. I cannot change that. If I am working with a parent who has PTSD, I had better be sensitive to that, because that is not going away. If I have PTSD, I better be doing some work on that, because that is not going away. The situation is stressful. It just is. Everybody in this room knows that. That's why you're all employed, because if it wasn't stressful, we would all be out of a job. And our biological responses are in that outer loop. They cannot be changed. The fact that they exist cannot be changed unless you are Phineas Gage or someone with a frontal lobotomy or something else where they're biologically different. What can we do then? There's four main areas. And this is an aggregate of a whole bunch of research. This is not one study. So if you ask me, if you email me, I can give you all of the studies. But for now, it's an aggregate. We can change our knowledge, our awareness, our activation, and then how effective we are at using tools. And we're going to go through that. When you have all those things working in concert, you create change. Now notice, change doesn't have to occur when all four intersect. You don't have to be superheroes. You don't have to be perfect. But if you can get a few of these things going, you can change quite a bit. So let's look at knowledge. The first thing we've all been really talking about is knowledge of our own physiology. So right now, I wore the wrong shirt because I'm really sweaty and I'm really nervous about speaking to you guys about this stuff. Because I work with kids and they don't scare me. But you're all going to leave here today being a little bit more aware of your physiology. You're going to notice when your heart rate is faster. You're going to notice, you're going to think in your head, my window of tolerance just expanded. Knowledge increase leads to better control of our emotion always. Knowledge of anything. That's why we develop prejudice as a society. Prejudice, developing biases and prejudice, is not abnormal. But if we're not aware of it, it can have very profound impacts on our behavior. The law. I am so excited to see all the booths upstairs, because hardly any of the parents that I work with have a really good foundational understanding of the law when it comes to special ed. And that's because it's really hard to know. So increasing your client's level of knowledge on the law and yourself will improve things. And then also the systems. What's the process? Someday I want to write a book, but I think it's already been written by somebody else. Because I am drawing 3-4 times a week. Here is the SST meeting. Then you go to this meeting. Then if your things aren't resolved, and I'm drawing and I'm drawing and I'm drawing. But it's not really readily out there. So what can you do in your respective knowledge in the general public, not just one-on-one.
on? Why doesn't everybody know the process? Then we move to awareness. So this is really where we're going to build our awareness of our own signs of stress and awareness and signs of stress in others. It's really much easier to know our own. But let's say we're in a mediation. Somebody starts, right, like adjusting. You want to have an instant reaction to that. If you're the facilitator, the mediator, I'm sure this is something you guys train on, so please forgive me. We teach this to kids. If your teacher is starting to change how they talk to you, you want to know why that's happening. What's going on? Is there something I'm doing? Do I need to talk through some of that in therapy when they come and see me? Activation, we're going to spend a lot of time on, but for now, activation is a word I use because I don't want you to assume that being stressed is bad. We do that sometimes. We say, I want to feel less stressed. Sometimes you don't need to feel less stressed. So instead of saying stressed or calm, we're going to talk about activation. So higher activation, where that amygdala is firing, or lower activation when we're really in our prefrontal cortex. Also, things like situational factors. Is your room too hot? It was too hot when we came in. We changed it to be colder. That was for your comfort, right? That was to reduce your level of discomfort and make you happier and me happier. Hunger and fear. If you're working with people who are eating one meal a day because they don't have the funds to eat many, their level of conflict or their window is going to be smaller. When you're hangry, And then effective use of emotional tools, we're going to spend a lot of time on that too. So this is the foundation of where we're going to go. Questions so far? We're all good. So how do we change? So we have to remember that the activation of fight or flight is adaptive. We want to teach that to people directly. When you feel stressed, that's good. You're not dead. You're alive. You're breathing. You have information moving inside of your brain into your awareness. But we have to learn to manage the reaction to match the needs of the situation. We don't want to, full body tackle husband who doesn't take the trash out. But we also don't want to freeze necessarily. It would benefit us to match. Neuroplastic change, so changing the actual structure and function of the brain, requires repetition. It's not going to happen overnight. Anybody hear of Lumosity? If you're a big fan, I'm really sorry about what I'm going to say. Lumosity is wonderful if you have a healthy brain, because it will increase. If you do it, it will increase your levels of memory and your levels of attention. It's not designed for kids and adults with learning disabilities. That's a misnomer. There's no data to support its effectiveness with those populations. But if you just want to keep your brain healthy, crossword puzzles. Neuroplastic change happens because of crossword puzzles. Knitting, Lumosity, running, all those things. But it requires repetition in order to be permanent. The following process that we're going to talk about can be applied at the individual, team, and system level. So we can neuroplastically change our brain, but we can do the same thing with our team and our system. If we want to get really excited about the entire special education or the entire mediation field, we can change the whole darn thing, but it requires repetitive change. I need a joke. Go for it. I appreciate it. I need water anyway, so that's good.
Okay, so I was on the Southwest flight, and it was a horrible landing. And as it, we're bumping over the place, and at the end, the pilot said, "Boy, I'm really sorry. Sometimes it's the plane's fault, sometimes it's the pilot's fault, and sometimes it's the ass fault." So, more in control and aware of our surroundings, that's when we can begin to be more aware of, boy, it's not that this is always happening to poor me, it's that this is a bad system, bad
awesome. And I'm going to give you one more example. I'm not taking a political stance on this. I'm not going to tell you an opinion on this. I'm just going to tell you a fact. The Black Lives Matter movement has caused a radical shift in our awareness of what's happening in our city. Not going to tell you an opinion because I don't know. I don't want to make any conflict. But what it's done is it's made us aware of something we were unaware of. Now we have to decide as a society how, like the amygdala, right? That's our amygdala, that whole movement. It gets us all fired up. Now what are we going to do about it? How are we going to use that information to look at our systems and to address fairness in our society? So here's the problem. Stress is completely subjective. There isn't a thing called stress. I can't measure it. I can't put it in a bottle. It's different for every single person. So what are we going to do? When you go to the doctor, you're in the ER, what's the first thing they ask you? Anybody? Right, on a scale of 1 to 10, Mrs. Fowler, how would you rate your pain today? Right? If anybody has had a baby or broken a bone or had spleen rupture, it's going to take a lot to get you to a 10. But when you're 4 and you're my son and you see blood, you scream, stare at your hand, and fall to the ground. Right? This happened the day before I got on the plane to come here. I screamed. So then what are we going to do? Tony Atwood. Anybody know of Tony Atwood? He's my soulmate. Don't tell my husband that. Plus he's Australian, so he has a wonderful accent. He championed really, I mean, so much more than this, but this is my absolute favorite. So he uses the metaphor of the thermometer. It's analogous to the window. It's a little bit different. So we're going to really kind of dive into this. But he uses the feelings thermometer with children with ASD. However, they apply to everybody, as we're finding a lot of things that work with kids with ASD work with kids of all kinds. All right, so up to you. You have notepads, you have crayons. They don't work that well. I apologize. They're from the dollar store. I tried them out. You also have pens. If you want to do this activity, you can. This is how I actually teach kids in therapy. I also teach parents this, and I teach special education teams, and I don't change it at all. It works the same. You could teach a police department this. Okay? Or on the back of your outline. So you don't have to draw it fancy, thank you, twistyneedle.com for your free graphic. You can just make it straight up with that one. But it basically goes 0 to 10. When we're using a system like this, we need to anchor it to standardize it. Just like we would standardize a set of scores if anybody's had statistics class, you have the normal curve, it's standardized data. 0 is that. Whatever you want to call that. So you could either use a word, like relaxed, or you could think of a time in your life, like hot tub, or vacation, or house of cards. I love watching. Why does that make me relax? That says something about me as a person. And then you want to anchor about halfway up, irritated or anxious, or a time that you felt irritated or anxious, or a different word altogether. And then you want to get your 10. Your 10 should really be a 10. It should be when you feel like you are losing your mind. So for a parent, I'll give you a quick example of that one. My daughter, who's now 9, was 4. We lived on a military base, very safe in general, right? Kids can run around. I go inside to get her brother, who was an infant at the time. Come back out, she's gone. 30 minutes. I had to call the police and tell them what she was wearing. That still makes me like, I just need a minute to take a breath right now. Because that still makes me upset, right? That's what you want for your 10. A lot of people, when we do this activity, they'll say 10, oh, that's that really tough meeting I was in. Unless you were on the floor crying, that's not your 10. Really go for it and say your 10. Now, in therapy, when I'm working with a kid, I do this over multiple sessions. We have a whole game. We have it on the floor. We have them jump. I give them activities. How about when your toy car broke and you jump to the number? You want to be able to anchor each and every number. We're not going to do that today because we'd be here all day. Here's what the data tells us. When we aggregate it, when we standardize these scores at about a 7, this is my thing I need. I need you and one more person. I need a volunteer. You get to be the purple minion. I'll be the purple minion. All right. Okay. So you guys are in a car. Okay, you drive, Claire. You're the prefrontal cortex, and you're the purple minion. You're the amygdala, right?
Okay.
Okay. At about a 7, frontal cortex out of the way in this driving car. So now you have to push Claire out of
the way. I'm the driver.
Now she's the backseat driver and she's in his ear, but oh, just wait. Okay? Very good. That was awesome. So you'll remember this later. Okay, so out of seven, the thinking brain takes a back seat. Don't let anybody tell you the thinking brain turns off. It doesn't turn off. You die. You just lay there. Right? But it does take a back seat, and it changes where the electrical impulses are flowing. Right, amygdala takes over. If the amygdala was a person, he'd be Mel Gibson in Braveheart. That's the amygdala. So, what we need to be able to do is to take our own temperature at will. The beauty of this, there's no language involved in this. All you have to do is teach a child or a parent or a system how to count from 1 to 10, and you know everything you need to know. If I said, Mrs. Fowler, I know you're late and you really have disappointed us, how do you feel about what's going on? She's going to be, this and that. If I say, what number are you? You're at a seven. All right, we got to address that before we move on because we're not thinking now. We're reacting. Nothing good happens. And that's not true. That's bad. Lots of good things happen. Parenting, collaborating, problem solving does not happen seven or above, only happens below a seven. So we have to learn, we're going to manage this, how to take our own temperature and then move ourselves and our systems up and down. That's what we're going to do now. Okay. The first thing we do is we have to front load coping strategies. We have to teach ourselves and others what are we going to do if we get a seven or above. We can't wait till we're a seven. Doesn't work. Maybe with some people. So we front load it. Load up the trunk before you put the kids in the car. Turn on the heat before you get in the car. All these kinds of analogies. So you want to think of things that work for you. I'll tell you what works for me. Running my hands underwater. No idea why. Feel free to analyze. Anybody else have something that brings your number down?
Eating chocolate.
Eating chocolate.
Exercise.
Exercise, what I hear over here? Music.
Visualize.
Wonderful. Deep breathing. So cheesy, so accurate. The first thing that lack of oxygen does, even a slight decrease, is it tells your brain that you are in danger. So all it takes, we know, is three very, very, very deep breaths. You will lower your number by one, guaranteed. So if you can teach yourself and your team to do that, that one strategy will work, but you have to have it preloaded, ready to go. Then you're going to take your temperature. So first we're going to talk about this internally. So we're in a meeting, and the guy leading the meeting, or the girl, sorry, has a PowerPoint, and they are reading slide, or bullet. My number is up, right? What I would hope for you today after this is that you're going to internally say, I'm not a seven. You're going to have an instant recognition. Or you're in a mediation, and what did you talk about? Tempers are starting to flare. Tone is changing. Volume is going up. People are leaning forward. People are making hand gestures. You want to be able to internally assess your number. If you are a seven or above, you engage in a strategy that you have already preloaded. So you're ready to go. Take your temperature again in a few minutes. If you're below a seven, keep going. Great job. If you're below a five or a six, you're good. Re-engage in the task. If you're still above a seven, abandon ship. Try something else. Don't just keep shoveling chocolate. People will start to know. Okay, so this is a cycle. So when I work with kids, and they're in a session with me, and we're playing Uno like we do all the time, and my kids rave that I get paid to play Uno all the time. But we're also talking about what's happening at home. Talking about dad being deployed. I'll stop the game in the middle. Number eight. Oh, we got to stop the game. What are we going to do? Pick your strategy. Pick a strategy. Do it. A couple minutes later, where are you at now? Four. Great. Re-engage in the game. If you can learn that cycle, you can keep any system, any child, yourself, at a seven or below, keep the prefrontal cortex engaged, keep the amygdala in the back seat. That's the goal. Very simple. It's the repetition that makes it neuroplastic change. It's the doing this like breathing. that makes it a change. Everybody remembers when you drove a car the first time, right? Everybody knows it's completely different now than it was before. I've never driven from Portland to Eugene. That was very stressful because I had never done it. I didn't have pre-laid down expectations. We okay with this? Questions? No? People move and I can get ready. Yes.
So, I can see this being really useful in mediation. It's just one of the ground rules that I usually go over. Talking quickly about here's the temperature, 0 to 10. I want people to stay below 7, so if you're getting above 7, let me know. Is this something that you can see working really well? For instance, in meetings, I can actually say, hey guys, here's some of the things that I've seen working well. I want to make sure that we're staying charged. So let me know before you're 0, then you're less late, but also let me know if you're getting above 7.
There's a particular school that I work with a lot. They're a private school, but they have a similar system to a special education IEP process. They have a giant thermometer, Velcro, and every 20 minutes they stop the meeting and ask, what's the temperature of the meeting? And if even one person feels that it's a 7 or above, they have a toolbox, which we're going to get to. They engage in a strategy until everyone agrees that they're below, and then they re-engage. They would rather have long meetings at low activation than a charged meeting for 50 minutes and everybody leaves feeling like they were either the prince, princess, or dragon and nobody got what they wanted. So you could use this overtly, like very literally. You could buy Tony Atwood's book, which already has it all in there. He has a ton of resources online. Or you can use it theoretically. And we can think about it at a systems level too. The police force is at a chronic because of their job. Are there ways, you know, this is well beyond the scope of what we're talking about, but are there ways to help them lower in general in certain neighborhoods and certain situations? So we're going to try a little awareness activity. This is a very, very fake IEP meeting by students who I don't know because this is open source on the internet. So I apologize if any of you know them. That may happen. This is a small world. I'm not disparaging them at all. We're not going to probably watch the whole thing because when we asked you what your roles were, I didn't necessarily expect that you would be so experienced, so you guys, this is not going to be new information to you. Here's what I want you to watch out for. Any signs that you see of fight or flight or freezing in the meeting, or just think about it if you don't want to jot it down. Do you see anybody demonstrate any awareness? Does anybody notice? How do the people in the meetings manage the stress or mismanage the stress in the meeting? And then are there any situational factors like language, setting, anything else that you think contribute negatively or positively to the meeting? I'm going to lower the volume. I don't know why, but whoever made this was like really excited about their topic. So here we go.
Yeah, I can create this. These poor guys are being thrown under the bus.
Yeah. Well, they started out by saying, we're here to discuss your son, not speaking to Jason. And then at the end of the sentence, you said, but we want to help you make educational progress. So it was like, I've seen this so many times.
We and you. We're going to do this for you. Can we count on you to do this? Do you agree with the goal we have developed? That's one of the biggest points from this video. It's amplified in this because these poor guys are students and this is probably their very first video, but it's not uncommon.
It was almost like that Jason time.
Right?
He was very defensive and
and nobody said anything about it.
Yeah.
Because we're afraid. Because we're afraid to say, your body language looks to me like you're uncomfortable and I don't want you to be uncomfortable. Start naming it, right? We talked about that earlier. It's okay to name signs of stress because it's going to connect us to our experience. Anything else? We're going to talk. I'm going to have some bullets too. Yes, Claire.
What was frustrating to me, again, it's my just being a mediator speaking, but it was frustrating to me that they already had their idea of what they wanted to do. They put them out there and they kind of said, you should do this. There was no bond-in from Jason or his father. They didn't have any investment in the process. And so if Jason tries those ideas and they don't work, he's not going to try harder to make those ideas work. He's going to come back to his teacher and say, hey, your idea didn't work. Right?
And that's one of the challenges of the system, because what we're going to talk about in a minute here, and I know we're winding down our time, is the constraints of the system tell the teachers and the special ed team, you got to develop some of this before they come in. So they're satisfying their job. It's very difficult. I have two kids who have gone through the SPED system. I guarantee you the third one will be there. I love him. He's a little wild. It's really hard to walk into a meeting that you're supposed to be developing an IEP with a team and see the IEP on the table written. Pretty frustrating. And if you don't understand why that's happening, if we didn't name it, if we didn't say, by the way, you're going to see this. This is our working copy. We would never do this without you. If we don't service it, I have an assumption, and I'm going to take a role, and there's going to be conflict. And I've been that person before. Okay, so some of the things that I noticed, there was definitely somebody in the power seat, and it was not the kid. here's a big pet peeve of mine. So who's been in IEP meetings or resolution meetings or anything? Okay, so where's the parent before the meeting? Like right before the meeting, 5 seconds before the meeting. Out in the hallway. Where's everybody else? Uh-huh, hanging out. So then I get to walk in to see everybody and their buddies hanging out. And then they say, let's introduce ourselves. Claire, introduce yourself to the mother. You introduce yourself to the mother. You introduce. So it's immediately, nothing's happened yet. Go ahead.
Well, the other thing that I'm not quite, the biggest pet peeve is when I'm sitting in the IEP meeting and the professional staff is saying, well, Mom, what do you think about that? Dad, what do you think about that? They're not in the mother, not in the dad.
Correct.
Absolutely inappropriate ways to address things.
Yes.
Absolutely.
So I have an idea, and if all of you do this, I'll become very famous. If you tell people I have, no one's ever done this that I know. I think 5 minutes before the meeting, everybody in the meeting should come out to the lobby and greet the parents and kind of mill around and talk and then say, let's go in together. I think that would revolutionize IEP meetings. I'm not kidding. I think it would change the level of activation. And it would change the level of conflict in every IEP meeting, every facilitation, every mediation.
That's the dollar.
It is. It's not published, though. You can steal it. It's okay. It's not my intellectual property. So we talked about we, him. Here's some of the great things. The team kept, if we watch the whole video, they really did get better over time. They asked him more questions. They were less directive. They tried to include him. They really played up his strengths and his progress. That helped mediate that level of activation. You would, if you had seen the whole video, you would see him get more comfortable as the meeting went on. The tone was positive and supportive, even though the language was not. And the members at the end expressed great gratitude towards him. They very much did thank him for being a part of the process. All right, there's Darth Vader. So stress is a ghost. It doesn't go away when we leave the meeting. If we leave a meeting at an 8, the next meeting we're going to start, we're going to probably start at about a 6 before anything ever happens. So the swamps of Dagobah, not that I'm a Star Wars fan, Luke has to go into the cave. He has to face his biggest fear that he might become his father. If he doesn't face the fear will haunt him and stay with him. Right? If we don't name what's going on, if we don't handle the stress, it stays with us and it's an aggregate. So it builds up and it builds up and it builds up. We know McEwen, in a study in 1998, talked about generalized or carryover stress, and that chronic stress in work environments leads to not only burnout, we knew that, but we get disconnected from why we're doing it. That's when we become robots. Oh, another IEP meeting. I had a teacher tell me, and I'm not going to tell you the word because it's a really bad word, I gave her a mug for Christmas, I'll never do it again, and she said, great, and AFM, another blanking mug. My kid with classes. Right? You get disconnected from what your task is. So it's not nature versus nurture, it's nature and nurture. Nature is our automatic response, it provides us information. Nurture is the behavioral change, and that provides the skills. That's the point of what we're doing today. What are the signs of major stress in a parent, child, professional that should be directly addressed during the special education process? So no matter what meeting you're in, anybody have an idea about, if you see this, the meeting needs to stop and we need to address it? There you go. Yay. Yeah, emotion. We get so sensitized to it, and then we almost feel like we shouldn't say anything about it. Or we'll just, no, it's okay to say, what are, you know, I'm a therapist, right? So we like to be cheesy. If your tears could say something, what would they be saying? I know, but then that might make you cry in there. You're going to look for body language, leaning in, getting aggressive with your hands. Pointing is a big one. This, different. This, that's a problem. Tone, change in perspiration. A decrease in questions and an increase in directive statements. Right? And then we've kind of talked about this. Yes, jump.
Blood is leaving the brain and going up to your stomach. So, on the way to the keto, it keeps different, right? So, as you notice, people are pushing,
Yeah. Pumping.
Yeah.
Small vessels will.
So, and it can be okay, but it might still be below the shadow, but it's a good number to be.
And it's non-threatening to say, what number are you? Versus, what's wrong?
Yeah.
Or, are you upset? I'm not going to say yes. I don't want to delve more into that. So what do we forget? We forget that parents often have no idea how the system or the law works. No idea at all. They're emotionally activated. They've often been inappropriately prepped. I just talked to someone who I don't think is in this session about in Virginia, we like to go from IEP meeting to due process. We love that. We don't like to mess around in the middle. So there's a lot of attorneys who do wonderful things, and there's not a lot of access to the services that would come before that. So a lot of parents, who was the person that said the thing about fighting? She did. So we don't have to fight every time, but parents are often prepped that they do have to fight. And they know more about that kid than you will ever know, ever. And I often will say that in a meeting. What do we forget about professionals? They're constrained. They're not fairy godmothers. Your mediators can't make the perfect thing come from heaven. They genuinely want to help. You have to follow a sequence of events during the process. You can't jump from an eligibility meeting to something else. And if you want a new category, you got to go back to the beginning, and that's the way it is. And the people on the team, they possess specialized knowledge and skills. They're not just bumps on a log. They're there because they're highly trained and they can help. They can do something for your child. So now we're going to talk some turkey. These are the things that we can do, right? We can manage the setting. We can increase the background knowledge of our parents. We can manage expectations. So I just had this experience with my neighbor. She went to her first SST student support team. I know it's different all over the country, the terms. The first meeting. And she came home and she said it was a disaster. And I said, what happened? And she said, they decided they needed an evaluation. I said, no, that's what you wanted. Now they're going to, and she said, no, they wouldn't give him an IEP. She had no idea that they were working well. And she left that meeting feeling like it had been a failure, and she wasn't even going to let them do the evaluation. Building awareness of signs of conflict, recognizing activation, using your tools, keeping your goals in mind, and using a facilitator. So here's some, what's the next slide? So what tools are you using to lower the temperature? This is theoretical, you don't have to tell me. This is something we should all be thinking about all the time. What tools do we have in our toolbox to be implementing these things? Free advertising, mediators and facilitators. Why are you amazing and awesome? Because you improve relationships. Because this is my favorite. You model what real prefrontal cortex driven communication looks like. And that's more powerful than any PowerPoint presentation anybody could give. You provide opportunities to resolve conflicts in the moment, not later, not at the next meeting. Oh, we'll table this and discuss it 3 months later when our timeline is up. You identify previously unknown options because everybody's operating within their own sphere. Typically, having a mediator or a facilitator will lower the general stress, and you support follow-through. And this is out of the Pacer Center of Minnesota, which I'm a great fan of, but I also love all of you in Oregon. They're also wonderful. I just love this one. This is how I feel all the time. I've been stressed. Yeah.
Can you go back to the benefits of the mediation
side? Yes. And I know I didn't hit them all because I'm not a mediator.
I did my doctorate on workplace conflict and looked at almost 4,000 conflicts, right? And one of the major things that I looked at was about a year down the road, could you characterize this conflict as being a positive experience? So I know it's uncomfortable to go through in the moment, but when you look at it later, did it end up being okay? Was it a positive thing? Are you glad that you went through that difficult conversation because it produced a positive change? So, with these 4,000 conflicts, I broke down what ones were positive. And the ones that were positive, what were the common characteristics of those positive conflicts? Okay, you tracking me so far? So, the ones that were positive, about 2 to 1, they said it was because we had access to a mediator. We had somebody who helped us talk through the difficult experience.
it wasn't that somebody told us how to do it, because that primarily ended up being a negative experience. If somebody else had control over the outcome, then it was a very negative experience for them. If people had control over the outcome, it was a very positive experience. But if there was somebody else guiding them to that outcome, then it was very positive. So people wanted somebody to help them talk through that difficult stuff. They wanted somebody to help guide them through that process, so long as that person didn't tell them what to do in the end. Does that make sense? So people want control over their outcome. People want to say, no, here's what I really need. I just need you to help me get there. Okay.
And because you're objective-ish, nobody's really objective, no one anybody's other. It's a golden opportunity and it's underutilized. At least I can tell you in my area, I've been there a year now, not one meeting has had a mediator or a facilitator involved. Not one. Hundreds of meetings all the time. So it's way underutilized and I'm super excited to be here because I'm going to take a bunch of stuff back. Here's my silly mouse again. So we're probably like super low on time, right? We might even be over time. Who knows? I'm really bad at managing time. Yay, we have enough time for like. Okay, so this is what I want you to do. I want you to, at your tables, make a plan. And I don't want it to be a theoretical plan. I want it to be, if everybody could identify a few things that you are going to go back and do, that you are going to implement with the people you work with, or in yourself, or somebody else. We're going to take about 15 minutes to do that, and then we're going to talk about it. Don't forget this stuff. Don't forget hate and all that, you know, hunger and big ideas like police force. I keep thinking about your example. So think big, think small, go for it 15 minutes, and then we'll check back.
Yes, it is on the clearvalva.com.
Okay.
The expectation that we collaborate on
coming
up.
Yeah,
okay.
We have our program, I'm with a mediation program in Michigan. We actually have a mediator training coming.
Hmm.
So some of this information, I want to find out what those research sources are because I want to share this information with our mediators. So we've already planned a segment on research on mediation, small group communication, and that sort of thing. So So this would fit right in. That's what I plan to do.
I'm an assistant superintendent in the district in Florida. It's a small rural community. But we have had a small group of advocates that have come into our area. They were with us about 7 or 8 years ago, and they have come back into our community, and we are really strong. We had about 28 state complaints last year. We only really had altercations with two of them, but the one particular lady that's driving this is at a 10 every time she comes into a meeting. So I think just working with our staff, working through some of these pieces, just an awareness that one of the ladies that is actually navigating into those meetings is with me through for the contract. And she does a lovely job, but it is really a challenge. So I think a lot of these pieces that she has shared today will be helpful. Even the simple things of like going out into the hallway and doing the introductions, because oftentimes they do come into a room of professional people, and many times the parents don't even realize what they're involved with until they get into a situation with the particular advocate, and then they had no idea that this was going to go down this path. You know, that's not the direction we want to go. That's because we pretty much know a lot of our people, because we're small, only 17 schools in our district. But anyway, I think this information is going to be extremely helpful because as we navigate this journey with the situation that we're dealing with. That's where we are.
Yes.
I love that.
Something really difficult to talk about. And if you suffer from something like this,
that, you know, it's not that the issues aren't there, they're very important.
Started doing some IP facilitation for three different reasons. One is every year I have anywhere between 100 to 150 new teachers who are fresh out of college and have no idea how to run an IP meeting.
Sure.
So I did a presentation this summer. I do a summer symposium for all new providers, and my topic was who put the F in IP. Not meant to be inappropriate, but how to facilitate, how to talk to parents.
Mm-hmm.
You're 22, and you're dealing with me as a parent.
Yeah.
So I apologize for interrupting your conversation, but what we're going to do is we're going to add to our Prezi anything that you guys come up with that sounds very specific and utilitarian for everybody. So that way, when we make it available to you online, you'll be able to see it. If you like the Prezi, it's very pretty, it's interactive. You can do way more than we did. Use it. It's definitely something that the kids nowadays, they're all.
We're planning to have a piece of that focused on new research in communication, mediation, small group communication, that sort of thing. So this would fit right in. So
perfect.
I'm going to steal it. I can't afford to pay it.
We're not selfish.
So thank you.
Both agree you have to start with every student and with every family, and we both have the thermometer and feeling. They don't just how important it is to understand where that, I think it's different with hearing loss and modes of communication and language. I don't know if that's what we got in the slide, the feeling's thermometer issue.
Yeah. Like you said, go to TonyAdler.com and look at how he applies this. He uses this with nonverbal kids with autism. Works just fine. Works with right of hearing kids. Works with adults who have emotional regulation problems. Works with everybody.
Well, so oftentimes, the parents of children who don't have those communication skills are very, they just like a conversation. So it can be very
difficult. Yeah. Are you in front?
Maybe kind of recalling the moment at which we had the worst sort of tension is a good way to reset the thermometer and not overestimate it.
Usually.
ideas, kind of feedbacks from the video and discussing good things, but just allowing IEP team to come to a better understanding of the context of the family. So, you know, telling the family story. And that's a buzzword, and it obviously can't take out, you know, more than 5 minutes of the IEP meeting,
right.
But somehow speak it in just to appreciate the story.
Right. I went to one of my children's recent 504 meetings, which was at 12 o'clock because kids have specials from 12 to 12:45, and I had to take off work. And the first thing they said when I got in there was, "We pre-prepped everything because we have to be really fast because I haven't eaten lunch yet."
Yeah.
Oh.
No family story, no understanding of my child. And I said, "Okay." We had a great meeting. It had nothing to do with them not wanting to help my child. It had to do with the restrictions in their environment. And if I had made that assumption, I might have become one of the roles that I didn't want to be, and it would have been bad. My kid now has an amazing 504, so much so that they said, "This is more like an IEP. Maybe we should just do an IEP." So I was in this, I was in this field before I had kids. So it's not, they're not all diagnosed because I was a psychologist.
Mm-hmm. And then I want to stake